Hello, hello everyone, it's Martin AK Anders after an incredibly long hiatus. Most of you know that I've been working with Fnatic over the last 6 months or so, including the major run-up to our quarterfinal run at Champions, so understandably, content has been a little bit sparse. But now that I'm back home, I threw a poll up on Twitter, and you guys got to vote on what content you wanted to see from me first. In fact, the result is here or here somewhere. I'll put it up on the screen. If you don't follow me on Twitter already, it's a great opportunity to stay in touch and even have some input on my content. But as you could all see, the thing that we're going to be touching on today is an agent concept that I've been fooling around with for a really long time, not something that I typically put up on this channel, but we're going to start diving into the agent I've codenamed Dust. Now, before we dive in forthright, I want to go through my ideation process here. I'm not a game designer. I'm not an agent designer. I'm not a dev. I am none of the above. So I'm going into this with what I believe to be a fairly logical process, but one that isn't industry standard by any stretch of the imagination, but it's what I went with, and I want to show you guys how I got to where I ended. That includes a multi-step process where first we tackle the fluff of the agent. This is something that I am completely out of my depth on. It's the lore, it's stuff that I really just sort of gloss over at a bare minimum level. Then we get into the design intent, which is really figuring out what niches exist in the game that aren't already covered and how we may be able to fill them. Then we get into the power fantasy of the agent. This is really the promise that you're making to the player when they select this agent, saying, you get to live this dream, you get to have this incredible impact on the game, and ensuring that that stays a core part of the agent's identity. Then you have the ability formulation. What does the actual concrete meat and potatoes of the agent end up looking like? And then you have reverse validation, which is going through, now that you have everything on the table, how do you break this? How do you say what I've created just isn't going to work because of X, Y, or Z reason? We have to nerf this part of it, buff this part of it. Where can this go wrong? So that's the process. Let's dive right in. Starting with the fluff, I tried to take really as quantitative and cookie cutter an approach to this as possible. I've listed out every agent currently in the game, including Agent 19, codenamed Sprinter, the Filipino Radiant character that's going to be coming into the game shortly. And the first thing we want to tackle is this agent's content of origin. We could get down more granularly to country, but I think that that is something that will sort of hash itself out more as you build through the kit of the agent, what thematically ends up making most sense. And I'm not a cultural expert by any means, so it's something that I don't trust myself enough to get into in a meaningful way. But if we look at which continents are most represented right now, South America is well behind the rest of the pack, and so that's what we're going to run with. Moving on to gender, we see that males are a little bit behind females right now, and the only agender agent is still going to be Kayo. For our purposes, we're just going to run with male here. Last, we land on Radiant versus Human. Does the agent have superpowers? It's a dead 50-50 at the moment, so we're going to go with the exciting one and stick with Radiant. A rapid recap, we're going to run with a South American male Radiant for Dust. Now we start getting more into really the ideation of the agent in its practical implications, and starting with the obvious one, what role slash class is it going to fill within the game? If we look at class representation, there are 5 duelists currently in the game and 4 of everything else, and rumor has it that Sprinter, when she is released, is going to be another duelist, so duels will be well ahead of everyone else. When I look at this, I say, okay, well, we have 3 roles to choose from, and the one that I end up leaning into is the one that currently has what I believe to be the worst variety of choice, and that's going to be the controller silo, where Astra is really just dominating everything right now. So now we can start analyzing the agents within that role in a vacuum. What's missing from this agent class that's leading to that lack of variety that I just qualified? For this, we're going to start leaning into some of the theory that I've presented in other videos. If you're familiar with my Mastering Macro series, how I handle primary role and sub-role types, as well as stylistic archetypes, you're going to feel right at home here. If you haven't seen those, I highly recommend them, and I'll put a link to them up in the top right corner. Going down the list, we have obviously primary type controller for all of these, but then we have a branch of a couple different subtypes. Astra's going to be subtype initiator sentinel, Brimstone's going to be subtype initiator, Omen's going to be subtype initiator duelist, and Viper's going to be subtype sentinel. As to why they're in each of these classes, you can go back to those videos like I said and itemize out their kit to know exactly how I landed here. Going a step even more abstract, we can start looking at what stylistic silos I drop these agents into. Primary type wise, Astra's control, Brimstone is aggro, Omen is aggro, and Viper's going to be control. And then we look at each of their subtypes, Astra being mid-range, Brimstone being mid-range, Omen being control, and Viper being aggro. There's a pretty clear lack of mid-range as a primary type here, so that's going to be the one that we run with the most. And then if we look at representation overall, it's really just a 50-50 of whether or not we want to go control or aggro. And I think that due to the fact that Astra is so prevalent right now as a predominantly control-y agent, I think giving a better option on the more aggressive side is what I want to go for here. So again, the rapid summary, we've got Dust, the South American male Radiant, who's going to be a primary type controller, secondary type duelist, who's a predominantly mid-range styled agent with an aggro subtype. Functional implications of this is that we're going to have a mid-range controller with dueling undertones who wants to fight, not entrench or stall. Their smokes need to be able to encourage fighting, not discourage it, and it needs to generate kills via its smoking. And when I say generate kills, I don't mean a smoke that literally kills people. I mean, this is a subtype duelist, and their smokes need to facilitate that in a very in-your-face, clear way. And so now we start looking at the ability formulation. How do we create an agent that hits all of the notes that we've created so far? Here I have an ability grid of every smoke in the game, categorized by their size, their duration, their credit cost, how many are available, their max simultaneous smoke count, their max simultaneous uptime. So if I can have three smokes down at once, what's the total time I can have all three of those smokes active? And then finally, the max uptime, all else being equal. So if I stagger all of my smokes, what's the maximum net uptime I can get in a round? In the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of these on a very detailed basis. Instead, I'm going to jump to what I decided to settle on and why I decided on that. I think in terms of size, we want an incredibly large smoke here, something Viper Poison Cloud sized. In terms of duration, we're talking about obviously a primary type controller, but one with duelist undertones. So how do we create a smoke that leans into that fighty nature? You just cut down the duration. You make it so that we're creating a smoke that wants to be capitalized, but has to be capitalized in a short window. We go to cost and we keep it low to sort of stay in line with that. And then we get to really the first dramatically unusual element here. I want to give this agent four smokes. They're going to be short duration. And if we think about mid-range stylistically, the whole premise is we want to be able to take and give space a bunch of different times throughout a round. And by giving them four short duration smokes, you lean very directly into that stylistic matching. This means that they can have a max of four smokes up at the same time, which some people might think is a little bit out of realm, but I've already started even getting a little bit ahead of myself here and have some really cool ideas for this. And I believe the input slash placement method for these smokes means that having four isn't completely out of the question, because by the time you've placed all four, you're going to have max 7 seconds left on them. This gives a maximum uptime if you stagger everything to 40 seconds of smokes, making it the lowest net smoke uptime of any primary type controller in the game, which I think is perfectly fine given the power that we're going to give it in other unique ways. So, in summary, mid-range nature is being expressed in high utility volume. This is going to be incredibly important to this agent. The short time frame of those smokes, however, encourages fast capitalization, staying in line with their secondary typing and the duelist subtype that we gave them, and the unique dynamic builds a fighter's smoke power fantasy. Now we get to get into the very cool stuff, and I'm excited to see what you guys think. That unique dynamic is what I'd like to refer to as a slatted smoke. Instead of being a solid orb, it's instead four wall-like smokes that are fully permeable, but there's directionality to them. This agent will place their smokes similarly to how Astra placed her ultimate, choosing which direction they want the slats of their smoke to go. This allows them to be a true duelist controller. They can smoke in a way where they can choose the lines of sight that they want to engage with. To show some proof of concept, we have here Astra placing her utility. If you do a more vertical smoke, it would look something like this. If you do a more lateral smoke, it would likewise look something like this. This ends up with a truly unique niche for this agent. These smokes are one of a kind, offer a billion different playstyle nuances. But we still have three pieces of kit to get through, so we better get a move on. Next up, I think that a duelist needs some sort of engagement tool, some sort of flash, so that's what we're looking at next. Here's every single flash in the game, the type of flash that it is, its duration, cost, count, the minimum time for it to affect someone, the maximum time for it to affect someone, and the time to draw, the time to get your weapon back out and shoot after using it. Similar to smokes, I'm not going to spend a million years going through all of these, but what I landed on was something, again, very unique. I don't want this to be a true flash. I think if you gave this agent a true flash, you're just creating a controller that's also a duelist, both in outright forms, and it's just overpowered as hell. So how can we dial that back a bunch? Instead of giving them a pop flash, I want to give them a pop stun. There's a very clear narrative amongst pro players that stuns don't feel like they do a whole ton. I think in this unique character's instance, you can get a lot of value out of them. So I think it's a great add-on to this kit to give them duelist-like power and entry facilitation, but in a way that isn't just outright busted. We'd make it a 2-second duration stun with a cost of 250, max charge 2, minimum time to effect of around half a second if you're throwing it basically right at the ground in front of you, and a maximum time to effect of around 2.5 seconds. So like a high arcing throw would get a decent amount of travel time here. Time to draw around 1 second. So very much so in that like a little bit faster than initiator, but still a bit slower than a true capitalizing duelist like a Phoenix. So in summary, we're introducing a distinctly duelist element to the kit, but one that isn't going to be role defining and make you feel like you're playing a duelist and a controller simultaneously. You'll still have a clear controller primary type. It preempts choice siloing by blunting a mechanic that otherwise may create a must-play scenario. If this agent had a true flash, it would just be 100% pick rate. Let's be honest. It would be pretty damn broken. Lastly, it has really easily adjustable levers in the event that it does create choice siloing. You can dial back how long this stun is, you can reduce the radius of the pop effect, like how large is the area that this stuns, we can dial that either direction, you can make the time to draw longer, you can increase the cost even if you really want to get down to it, but this is something that is easily slideable. It's something that could be nerfed or buffed as necessary to ensure that this stays a controller and doesn't become a duelist. It would have the same propelled projectile mechanics that, say, a snakebite would or a slow orb does. And so in this situation, we would be throwing it towards tree on ascent A, and I think it would have to explode on impact with any surface. So hits the door frame, pops, there's your area of effect. If you're within that, 2 second stun to you. If we threw it towards the ground in front of us, pops, and flashbang, it would be just outside of the radius of stunning ourselves at that point. If you throw it towards a main, it's a large enough blast radius that it almost affects the entirety of that corridor. At this point, my mind sort of run away with this agent. I have a really good idea of where I want things to end up, and so I'm going to give you a summary of the way I thought the rest of the kit would hash out. I think that these first two abilities are so potent that the third one really has to be a bit of a dialed back rider element to the kit. And then the ultimate has to be something pretty powerful, but not something overly oppressive. Something that's going to have fairly conditional use case in that you probably want it for post-plant situations almost in exclusivity. And so thematically at this point, I've ended up with a male South American agent that's probably sand or dust themed, hence the code name that I gave you all at the start of this. We're talking about someone that, in my mind at least, has like two earthen arms that may be like floating, almost sand bending-esque look to them, and this is the kit that they end up with. The first ability, sieve, is the smoke. Sand through a sieve, dirt through a sieve. It makes a lot of sense just from a pun perspective. This is a smoke that has holes in it. It's meant to be seen through. When using Sieve, Dust crouches and melds his arms with the ground below to enter an earthen state. This is the way that he's going to get into sort of that overview, astral form, spectral plane, if you're looking at Omen, that way of placing smokes on a global basis. Viewing the map from within, in this form, Dusk can press primary fire once to select a placement location, and a second time to confirm the direction of four wall-like sandstorm cascades per charge that block vision but are otherwise wholly permeable. This is a 4-charge, 10-second duration, 100-credit smoke, as we explained before, and one of these charges will be the inherent rewarded smoke that he gets at the start of each round. His Q ability would be buff it. You equip a swirling orb of sand, fire to launch the orb forward, bursting outward on impact with any surface, stunning all those in a close radius, max 2 charges, 2-second duration, 250 credits. There's that concussion. His next ability, Sandblast, is where I'm going to start losing a lot of people because it's not going to be a popular idea, but I love it. On use of Sandblast, equip Earthen Fists of Compressed Sand, fire to blast forth the compressed sand in a shotgun-like burst before you. This is Chambers Headhunter, but instead of a sheriff, it's a max 3 charges of a shotgun. We're talking about an agent that thematically is meant to fight people, has smokes that allows very unique lines of sight. It's the easiest to rat around smoke in the game. If you're telling me that this person doesn't naturally want a shotgun, you're crazy. It's so thematically in line with the rest of this kit that it is borderline absurd. And so what does that end up looking like? I think you give them max 3 bullets, so one more bullet than a shorty, 150 credits per bullet. This is something that we don't want to get too oppressive. We don't want to make it like an unfun mechanic, but it has a 2 round per second fire rate. So we're not firing as fast as a judge, but we are firing quite a bit faster than a Bucky. So we get those 3 shots off fairly quickly when we're firing them flat out. The damage is where I will concede I have no idea what the hell I'm doing. We've got a bunch of numbers here, which is basically dialed back judge numbers that are then halved because I want to grossly increase the number of pellets as well as the spread radius of this shot. I think that we want to look at something here that doesn't feel like a shotgun, but feels like you're literally spraying forward a burst of sand, like hundreds of little pellets. In this case, it's 25 just because of functional restraints, but I want each pellet to be very low damage in a very wide spread so that it's mostly chip damage unless they're literally up in your face. And then we get to the ultimate, which I had to do it. I'm a Magic the Gathering player. I'm also a Warhammer 40,000 player. And so there's an infamous saying, all is dust. It's a board wiping mechanic in Magic. It's the saying of a certain army in 40K. It is too fitting here not to use. So the ultimate ability, all is dust. On use, you equip a vortex of sand. Fire it to stir up a violent columnal dust devil at your location. For those of you who don't know what a dust devil is, it's this wild thing. Basically a tornado of sand, a concentrated sandstorm. When inside the dust devil, all players are nearsighted and all players excluding dust take 5 damage per second. This is a low tick rate damage, but it is legitimately damaged. This isn't decay that you would get from Viper. This is a very low tick rate amount of legitimate damage that you are taking. Any projectiles fired into the Dust Devil are repelled as if colliding with a wall. This is a giant swirling vortex. It is anti-post plant, so we get that conditional use case that we were looking for. Any projectiles fired within the Dust Devil are propelled out of the column along a ray from its center point. So if you shoot stuff at this, it bounces off like there's a wall there. If you shoot it from within, it's launched out directly the opposite direction. It would be a 7-pip ultimate, and to keep it from being just the most overpowered post-plant tool in the game, you're looking at only a 20-second duration. The damage take makes it very easily spammable if you're an attacker trying to keep your own plant alive, but it's also not so egregious that if you're trying to defuse as a defender, you're going to die before you can get a channel off. This ultimate also culminates in a way that makes sense with the rest of his kit. This is a dueling controller, and his ultimate is this giant effing sandstorm that forces everyone to come and fight him in a way where he can even hide inside of this with a shotgun that's naturally part of his kit. All of it is very poetic in the way that it meshes and melds together. And so now we can sort of summarize things, looking at playstyle novelty. He creates directional smokes to enable streamlined executes and space taking up multiple game phases, reflecting both the mid-range and aggro natures of the agent. He provides opportunities for the player themselves to capitalize on a complex mechanic, their smoke, unique to their own agent, in an otherwise supportive role silo. Those opportunities are further amplified by a tool designed in large part to aid in that capitalization. We're looking at that shotgun. It's meant to be used around these ratty smokes. And we still include a semi-supportive utility in a format that can be self-capitalized, but in a non-traditional sense. We're talking about that concussion under specific conditions, and it requires very effective use of the rest of the kit to get maximum value. You want to use your smokes to isolate someone on the site, be able to get your concuss off in a way where you're throwing the projectile forward, it can't bounce off walls, so you have to use your obstructions to get off something valuable here. And last but not least, and this is something that is very tangential but also definitely worth mentioning, it leverages existing mechanics and input systems to reward players who are role specialists. The fact that it uses a mechanic that already exists and is semi-unique to Astra says, hey, I understand that you're a controller main and that that role is very unrewarding from an individual playmaking perspective. So we've created an agent that not only gives you those opportunities, but gives you a transferable skill set. At long last, we get to the power fantasy, which technically should have come sooner, but I think in terms of my own flow just ended up here. We made a dust or a sand radiant here. It creates cascading sandstorms to provide a unique space-taking tool to their team, and they can be wholly self-sufficient. They have smokes and a pop concuss when played at the absolute pinnacle of this agent. They can blast their opponents with those same sands when ratting around their unique and nuanced smokes, and they can summon a giant sandstorm or a dust devil of epic proportions to deny opposing utility and further create a gunfight and play-focused game. The last step is the reverse validation. We've created this crazy agent, and now we have to figure out how can it be broken. And where this video is already getting crazy long, I'm gonna leave this part to you guys. Down in the comments below, tell me how you would break this agent. What is so out of place here that you think it would have to be changed if this agent was ever gonna go live? And so that's dust, I guess. I mean, this agent really stemmed from me having the concept of a slatted smoke a while back and thinking, what the hell else would their kit look like? It really took on a life of its own, and it's something that I think has some very legitimate merit to being introduced into the game in some way, shape, or form. There is a clear, like, duelist-y niche missing in controllers right now, and where we've seen that lack of meta variation, where it's become just entrenchment stall, global presence, this, that, the other thing. Having a more fighty controller would be a welcome change of pace. So, really eager to hear your guys' thoughts down in the comments below. Do you think this agent is ridiculous? Do you think any of the mechanics would just be completely out there and broken? Really excited to hear things, and for those of you who saw that Twitter poll where we decided to do this in the first place, you know I've got two other videos coming out in very short order. Really happy to be back, getting content out for you guys, and I will hopefully see you again even before the new year. Thanks as always for watching. I'll see you in the next one.